sunshine, temperature's a little warm, and we're in the house of the Lord to worship Him and to honor Him and to collectively praise Him. It's great to be in the house of the Lord. And for those of you who are at home watching on Facebook, thank you also for taking time out of your day to worship with us from a remote location. But we are still one collective body no matter where we may be. So we're going to read a passage this morning from James 1:22-24. I can't read it because I forgot my reading glasses. And I couldn't find any. I'm going blind. It's okay, Ms. Crespo, but I'm going to paraphrase it. Basically, the passage talks about what good is it to hear the word and to just only hear the word and not to put it into action. And the passage goes on to say, well, what is it for a man to walk by a mirror, stop and look at himself, and then walk away and immediately forget what he looks like? And when I read that, I chuckled a little bit. I thought, that's kind of funny. And I started thinking about it a little bit and said, no, that's not very funny. No, that's serious. After thinking about, we can hear the words, but if we don't put it into action, then we're no different than, for those of you who can remember the Peanuts cartoons, the teacher, what did she say when she talked to them?
Walk.
Right. I mean, Pastor Darrell can sit up here and talk, and he will sound like that. If we don't take the words, not that he does, and put it into action, we have to, otherwise it's meaningless. So let's pray on that this morning as we go into this worship. Please pray with me. Yes, Lord, it's easy for us to hear the word. That's not hard at all. But really where the word comes alive is when we put that word into action. And how does that look like? Well, that looks different for everyone. Because to put your word into action is a constant and continual process. It just doesn't happen during an hour of worship on Sunday morning or at any other specific time of the week. It's continual, just like your word says to pray without ceasing. It's a lifestyle. It becomes or should become second nature to us just as we breathe. We don't even think about it. We just put it into action almost as an automatic reflex. Easier said than done. I mean, everyone here at one time or another feels like they want to punch somebody in the nose. We're all human and we're all subject to those emotions. And I mean that literally and metaphorically. But Lord, we know that that's not how you want us to approach things. Among so many other ways of living, just love one another, which you tell us to do. So this little Lord, this morning as we are here to worship you, we ask, we pray, we plead that you give us. Now let me rephrase that. We pray that you allow us to lean on your strength and capability to overcome our brokenness so that we can hear the word and apply it, because we can't do it on our own. You've paved the way, but now we have to follow the way. Please make it so, Lord Jesus. This we ask in your name.
Good morning. Welcome. It's so wonderful to see all your beautiful faces again and have you here with us and be able to worship with you. God's word says in Hebrews chapter 10, verses 19-23, therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain, that is his body, and since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with the full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. We invite you to stand and reflect on these words as we worship today.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine.
Story. morning we have sung Blessed Assurance, we've sung Everlasting God, and we've heard Trust and Obey. And we as Christians take for granted what God does for us. He assures us, we rest in Him. He's our everlasting God. He won't grow weary or faint. He keeps us going. And now it's our turn to let other people know who Jesus is, to know what it feels like to be assured, to know what it feels like to have an everlasting God who never grows weary. And so as we go into the next songs, it's about us going out and realizing that we are sinners. We are sinners, and we are only saved by grace through faith. And we have the honor of sharing that with other people. So as I read from Matthew, and as we sing the song, Jesus, Friend of Sinners, I want you to really focus on the words. They are just, they're wonderful. And so think about that as I read. I'm reading from Matthew chapter 25, verses 34 through 40. And they are the words of Jesus. Then the king will say to those on his right, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you?" The king will reply, "Truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did it for me."
People in your name, but the story was never. Oh, man. Each week I get to see faces that I hadn't seen in so long. So good to see you. Greetings in the name of our Lord. He wants you to know how much he loves you, how much he cares for you, how much he's with you, how much he wants to walk with you. Well, there's no division. And we long for that day when we in Christ shall be separated no more. And we won't see dimly. We will see clearly. And we will be with our Father as he intended us to be. What does that look like? Beautiful. Okay, let's go with that. Pray with me. Heavenly Father, God, we talked this morning about emotions. We've been talking this month about emotions, and you are the creator of emotions. And you instill in us that image of yourself that loves to see things created, that loves to see things encouraged and encompassed and surrounded and hugged and loved. And you also oppose the things and hate things. But Father, you are the one who knits all things together, and you've knitted us together with you again in Christ. And so this morning, as we open up our hearts and as we open up our eyes and our ears and we hear a word from you, Father, bear with us, be with us. Let us to hear a word from you, please. In the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ, amen, amen. We've been talking about emotions this week, and today I'm going to be in Isaiah, the Old Testament book of Isaiah, chapter 58, and I think I'm going to start somewhere around 6. We'll see how the Spirit moves. Max, I've got my glasses. You know, we're so many different things fissured these days. Fissured, taken apart, broken. We see things that were once we thought were together and unified and couldn't come apart. Now we see things that are broken. We see things that have cracks in them. We see things for what they are sometimes, even in this country, around the world, in our health, in our well-being, our friendships, in our church, in our economy, and so many different things. We see fissures, we see breakings, and it's not to the end, I don't believe. I think it is for our encouragement. I think God is showing us some great and mighty things about who he is, and about maybe what we have put our trust and our faith in, and maybe how we've let our emotions get away with us. We've been talking about how emotions are given by God. They're given by him. But how sometimes we corrupt them and we don't use them quite the way that he wanted us to. Deep inside what he wants us to do, that he loves us. He hates some of the things that we do. But one thing about our God, he is not apathetic about his creation. He doesn't just say, unimportant. He cares. But you know what? For us, we do need to have apathy about certain things. We know that we need to hate things that God hates and oppose them and stay away from them. We're supposed to love the things that God loves and let it become part of us. And the love that he has, that even though we don't even understand it sometimes, is all-encompassing and all-loving and all-caring. And he wants to love his creation, even while hating and opposing the things that have perverted his creation. But one thing I don't believe is God, I don't believe he's apathetic. I don't believe he just doesn't care about anything. And he doesn't want you and I to be that way either. And so maybe there's some things in your worldview, where you say, I don't really know. I really don't have an opinion. And maybe it's something that's very, very strong in our community and very strong in our society that we need to have an opinion about as Christ followers, because sometimes we need to be able to stand for what's right. And so we have to formulate an opinion. So I don't believe, as Christ followers, we should be apathetic about many things that matter. What was that old quote that I used about Bob Goff a few weeks ago? It used to be, Bob Goff said, it used to be that I was worried about failing at something that mattered to me. Now I'm worried about succeeding at something that doesn't matter. That's unimportant. And that's the way that we should be in Christ. We should want to be successful at the things that God places in us to do, that are important as far as he's concerned. And the fissures and the cracks and the breaks that we see in our relationships or in our personhood, he is the great welder. He is the great one that can put us back together and do away with the cracks and the fissures, even in our community, as he does in ourselves, even in our nation, and even in the world. And one day God will stand in a recreated existence for us. He will stand in a place for us that he has said, I have gone to prepare a place for you. If it weren't so, I would have told you. But he has. And I long for that day. Until then, here I am. Here I am. You know, I was listening to some people talking, joking this week about the theory of everything. And they use it as a joke. And I thought to myself, you know, the theory of everything is not a joke. Let me really quickly tell you the theory of everything. See, we have things that are controlled by gravity, okay? General relativity. We have things that are controlled by gravity. And we have things that hold things together, little bits and pieces that we can't even see. We don't even understand them. And those are the quantum mechanics. That's the finite, the infinite little bitty tiny things that we look at and through microscopes and try and understand all that. And they are served in a completely different way. Whereas gravity deals with large masses like planets and things like that. These other non-gravitational forces hold everything together. And the theory of everything, all these beautiful, wonderful minds in physics and in science have yet to understand how those two things go together. And that's called the theory of everything. And the unified theory. And it was so funny when Justin, I sent him this week's message, weeks ago. I mean, I told him what we'd be talking about. And I said, unified theory. And he goes, could you maybe, expand on that just a little bit? I usually do. I try and tell him exactly where we're going to be going. But I understood. I said, well, you know, unified theory, man. It's the theory of everything. It's the theory of how all things go together and work together. And we don't understand it. Physicists don't understand it. They've not put it together yet. But you know what? There is a theory of everything. And it's in God's word. And it's in God's spirit. And it's how he takes us. And he welds together inside of us an understanding and a comprehension of who he is. And the things that we can't understand. And I believe that we need to understand as much as we possibly can. I love science. I believe we should understand things as best we can. But the bottom line is, we're not always going to understand everything. I have a quote here. And the quote is, if we do discover a theory of everything, it should, in time, be understandable in broad principle by everyone, not just a few scientists. Then we all, philosophers, scientists, and just ordinary people, be able to take part in the discussion of the question of why it is that we and the universe even exist. If we find the answer to that, it would be the ultimate triumph for human reason, for then we would know the mind of God. You know who said that? An atheist, Stephen Hawking. If we could know these things, then we would know the mind of God. But you know, our God loves us, ordinary people. And he's come alongside of us and says, I have no mysteries. I want to tell you what you need to know in order to walk with me and to have everything put together that you need to understand and comprehend for your walk on this earth so that you can be my ambassadors, that you can show love, that you can show grace. And it's not a fissure. It's not a broken thing that I want. I want unification. And when I look out here in this congregation, this beautiful congregation, I see people with so many different talents, so many different abilities, and I see and know so many different opportunities that God has given you to serve him. And that starts knitting it all together. So then when we read the generalities and the specificities in Scripture, we can read about us, and we can read about us. Isaiah 58. I'm going to start at chapter 6, 58, verse 6. Now, what he's been talking about is fasting, okay? And I'm not going to go into fasting today, but fasting is taking away something that you really need in order to exist so that you might be able to focus a little bit better on the core of existence. You get me? Sometimes we don't eat, we fast, and we take away that necessity we know that we have to have. We have to be able to eat, we have to give ourselves fuel, we have to be able to keep going. But sometimes when we fast and we take that fuel away and we can become a little bit focused on our hunger, and then after a while, I don't know about you, but after a while my hunger starts to focus on greater things. And that, I believe, is what God wants. But God doesn't just want us to do away with food. No, he wants us to deal with the other things in our lives that we really feel that we need. But he wants us to be pouring them out to others just as we pour ourselves out to him. And he starts and he says in verse 6 of Isaiah 58, he says, "Is this not the fast which I choose," God says, "to loosen the bonds of wickedness, to undo the bands of the yoke, and to let the oppressed go free?" Those are things that God hates. He opposes them. He stands in contrast to them. He does not want that to be. He says, "Loosen the bonds of wickedness, break the bands of the yoke, and let the oppressed go free and break every yoke. Is it not to divide your bread with the hungry and bring the homeless poor into your house? When you see the naked, to cover them and not to hide yourself from your own flesh." These are the things that God loves for us to do. "That your light will break out like the dawn, and your recovery," because we are broken, "your recovery will speedily spring forth, and your righteousness will go before you. The glory of the Lord will be your rear guard, and you will call and the Lord will answer. And you will cry and he will say, 'Here I am.'" He won't stay hidden from you. "If you remove the yoke from your midst, the pointing finger and speaking wickedness, and if you give yourself to the hungry and satisfy the desire of the afflicted, then your light will rise in the darkness and your gloom will become like midday, and the Lord will continually guide you and satisfy your desire in scorched places and give strength to your bones. And you will be like a watered garden and a spring of water whose waters do not fail. And those from among you will rebuild the ancient ruins. You will raise up the old age foundations. And you will be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of the streets in which to dwell." God is saying right here, there are things that I hate. I hate the yoke that's on the oppressed. I hate, and we're oppressed. When we allow the things of this world to take control of who we are and to dictate what we do and how we act, we are oppressed by this world. God opposes that, and he wants us to be free. And when he frees us up, he wants us to be in love with his creation. He wants to see it for what it is, a beautiful gift from him to us that we see and acknowledge and live in, but it's broken and it's got fissures, and because of those fissures he wants us to be the welders, to come in and step in and to feed the hungry and to clothe the naked and to free the oppressed. He wants us to do those things. Why? Because he loves those things. And he tells us, he said, then your light will break out like the dawn. You will no longer be apathetic. You will no longer say, "Well, it's really of none of my concern. I don't know one way or the other about it. I don't know." No, he won't allow us to be apathetic. He said, when you let me work and when you let me break into your life and do the things that I want to do in your life, you will become like the dawn in yourself and then to others. You will become the restorers of the breach. You will be the ones that have taken those age-old foundations and redone them because they have been broken. And God wants to call us into a loving relationship with him. And he doesn't want our relationship with him to be broken or fissured. He wants us to just, he wants us to find the theory of everything and put it all together. And hate the things that he hates and loves the thing that he loves, and really be circumspect and look deep inside of ourselves and say, what are the things that I could be doing for the Lord? What has he shown me that I have said, well, that's none of my concern? And we do that, we become dangerous. We become dangerous citizens on this planet. When we go against the things of this world and the important things of this world and the wickedness and the pointing finger and the speaking of wickedness about each other, when we quit doing those things and we try and love, and we try and oppose, and we try and love and build each other up and encourage each other, then God is glorified. Then God is honored. Then we start to understand what our life looks like when it comes to, I don't know, whatever is breaking us apart right now. You fill in the blanks, all right? There's a few things that's breaking us up. As a people, as a world, there are some things that are breaking us apart, that are cracking us apart. Even those of us that felt we were strong in the Lord and comprehending the Lord. And it's not just the acts that we do. It's the reason that we do them. But God says there's fissures, there's breaks, there's cracks. And we need to shore those up. So no longer are you a broken vessel. And now you're a healed vessel. And you know what it means to unify hatred, love, and to fill the gaps of apathy. And then, I look forward to seeing what God wants to do with us. And you're right, we were talking about that earlier, about how can we be an ambassador to the world? How can we be you have an ambassador, you send an ambassador to keep good relations with other entities, right? That's why we send ambassadors out, because there's strained relations, or we don't comprehend each other, or we have different values, or we have different, but Jesus said that you're going to be my ambassadors. And I'm going to send you out into all the world. And what I want you to do is I want you to be that soothing aroma that the Old Testament, they would have the spices and the things that they, the smoke that would go up the sacrifice, a soothing aroma to God. I want you to be that soothing aroma. And I want you to be my ambassadors, Christ says. And I want you to go into a world that's broken and crushed and doesn't know the way forward, but I am the way and the truth and the life. And nobody is going to get it figured out unless we go through Christ to the Father. And so knowing that, and you know what I just reminded myself of also, that's what I'm talking about on Wednesday nights. We're talking about the book of Romans and about how God wants to knit us all together, and how my reading, my personal reading and my professional reading and my professional studies for teaching and preaching and speaking on Wednesday nights and it all knits together. I keep finding more and more that every time I open a book and I start reading something, it strikes me how God is the grand weaver, and he weaves all of our life together when we love him, when we're purposed for him, when we want to grow in him. And he says, these are the things I want you to do, and here's what will happen. If you'll notice in here, there's a lot of if-then statements. There's a lot of if-then statements. If you look at verse 7, is it not to divide your bread? If you divide your bread with the hungry and bring the hopeless in, the homeless in, and you see somebody naked and you cover them, and you don't hide yourself from your own flesh, verse 8 says, then your light will break out like the dawn, and your recovery from your brokenness will speedily spring forward. He wants you to know that you're broken. He wants you to know how you can fix it. When you help others, whenever you're doing the work of the Lord, if you do those things, then your righteousness will go before you. The glory of the Lord will be your rear guard. And then it goes on to more if-then statements. He said, then you will call out to the Lord and he will answer. You will cry and he will say, here I am. And here's another if-then statement. If you remove the yoke from your midst, the pointing of the finger and speaking wickedness, and if you give yourself to the hungry and satisfy the desire of the afflicted, then your light will rise in darkness and your gloom will become like midday. And he goes on to say, and the Lord will continually guide you and satisfy the desires in scorched places and give strength to your bones. And you will be like a watered garden and like a spring of water whose waters never fail. And those from among you will rebuild and restore. And that's what it takes, folks. It takes us understanding, not just a month of love in February and everybody buys things about love and everything else, but understanding love's proper position in our lives. Those are the things God wants you to embrace. You're to love the things that he loves. But you know what? As part of it too, hate. Remember? Hate. And he says, and oppose the things that I'm opposed to. And man, that's something that it's easy to be loving sometimes. It's easy to say, well, I love that. But you know what's really hard sometimes? Is in the face of others who may disagree with you, say, but I hate this because God tells me he hates this. But oh, how he wants to knit these things together. All these things that we were made in the image of God. He wants to knit these things together, and he wants us to become the true ambassadors, the true children of the sons of God. In his book, Ravi Zacharias, you know, and you guys might know Ravi Zacharias. He passed away here a while back, and after he died, some terrible things came out about him. That he was not exactly always the man of God that he should have been. That he was not always the pure person that we might have looked at him and presented, you know. And I've told the story 1,000 times that whenever I was working on a lock in Louisiana one time, and this guy, a carpenter named Chris, a preacher from that area had sinned, and I went to him and I said, Chris, I said, what about your buddy Jimmy Swagger? He said, oh, Daryl. Always, he was a good, this young man was a great Christ follower. He said, oh, Daryl, you have to look around people to see God. If you don't, they're closer to God than you are. You got to go around them. We're a broken people, and we're trying our best to become whole again. And the only way we can do that is to let the grand weaver, God, weave us together. And Ravi Zacharias said, how much more grand is the work of our Heavenly Father as he pulls together all the varied strands of this life to reveal his grand design. And as we walk with each other, and as we see the failings of each other, and as we see the good things in each other, as we see the abilities of each other, and the opportunities that God gives each other to do his work and his will, we see that grand design where he pulls all those strands together and weaves that wonderful tapestry that is his creation. And then we start to disregard the things that he does not care for. And we start to look for the important things in our life and how we can serve him and how we can serve each other, how we can be in love with each other, and yes, even oppose the things that God hates. The only thing we cannot do is on the important issues to stand with a question mark over our head. We need to love and we need to give. And it says that in Scripture over and over and over. And if you read Scripture, people said, well, the Bible contradicts itself. Well, come talk to me about that, because I am a student of the Scripture, and I am honestly trying hard sometimes to find something where it just disagrees with itself. And when I think that I've found it, sometimes God will just reveal it to me. Sometimes he reveals it to me himself, or sometimes he reveals it to me through other writings. Other people, men and women who have gone before us. But what he asks us to do is to fall deeper and deeper and deeper in love with him. And as we do, we start to comprehend the things of this world will go strangely dim. But our affections and our understanding of him will grow much, much keener. And that's what will carry us through these times. That's what will carry us through this brokenness, these issues that we have with each other, and the ways that we fight against each other and we push against each other and pull against each other. And he's saying, be united. The only way we can be united and unify all this is in Christ, because his morality or his decisions or what he loves and what he hates doesn't change with the seasons, folks. It doesn't change with the state border or the country line or the political party or the whatever. It does not change. God is immutable. He does not move. He does not change. And the more we understand him and the more we understand our history, the history of man, the more we understand God has been at work in his creation and continues to be at work in his creation, and continues to draw us closer and closer to him individually, collectively, for his good pleasure. What's our vision here at the church is to bring glory and honor to God forever, because he is forever. He's the great I Am. He was, he is, and he will be. And will we be also? I go to prepare a place for you. If it weren't so, I'd have told you. You wouldn't have to worry about it. Unified in Christ. That's what I want us to get out of this whole month. That our emotions are important. God's given us emotions. He wants us to, and trust me, there's a lot more than just love, hate, and apathy. There's many, many, many emotions that we have, but he says, use them for my good pleasure. Understand everything in my reflection, not in your own. And as you knit all these things together, and as you see me at work, you won't become more discouraged. You will be more trusting and obeying, because only he can weave all this mess together. It starts with you and your brokenness. And it starts with me and my brokenness. And it knits us together as not just brothers and sisters in Christ, but as a unified force to show people what it means to be a Christ follower, to show people what it means to be in love with the God of all creation. Well, Father, I thank you so much for your goodness to us. I thank you that you have come and you have been with us, that you have revealed yourself to us. We may not understand completely how things work, Father, in this universe. We may not completely understand how all things stay together. But you tell us by your might and by your hand and by your love that you have knitted us together in our mother's wombs, and you know everything about us. You love us, you created us, and you can fix us, you can break us when you need to, because we need to see your face, we need to see who you are. And we cannot let ourselves be soothed to sleep in apathy because things are pretty good. Father, thank you that you shake us sometimes, that you rustle us out of bed and out of our slumber, and you tell us, I love you. I can't leave you alone because you have things that I want to see done. I want to see you use the opportunities that I give you. I want to see you reach out to the loved ones that may not know me. I want you to be an ambassador to me, utilizing all the things that I've given you that I might be glorified. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen.
As we close out, and we're a city on a hill. You got that. Let your light shine.
types of light. There's the reflection, and there's the source. We know who the source is. Now we just have to be the reflection. All right, church, let's go out there and be the reflection of God, our Savior, our Father. If I can help you in any way, shape, or form during the course of the week, please call me. Let me know what I can be doing for you. God bless you. We're all, there's a bunch. Love you guys. Look forward to the day when we can take this blue tape off and all this mess. But until then, I'm going to be a good steward of you. I appreciate you being a good steward of each other. Love you guys. Have a great week. Call me if I can be of any help to you. Thank you.